I want to begin my talk with an apology. I know it's wrong to do it, but still. The apology comes from the place where I feel that when I'm speaking to people of faith, let's call them believers, I speak in a different language than they are used to, or they perhaps want to be listened to. When I'm speaking about believers, I'm speaking about people who believe in some sort of divine entity, okay? And they believe that, for example, things that happen on earth are not happening for no reason. But they believe that things that happen on earth and things that happen to nations and to the planet or even to them personally are occurring for a specific reason, and that reason is that divine entity who many call God, and this is their belief. On the other hand, there is another group of people who are also believers, but they don't believe in the same beliefs as the first believers. So we will call that second group rationalists, okay? Rationalists also believe. I don't know anyone who doesn't believe that the sun will rise tomorrow, although there is no reason to expect that if it so happened for the last, I don't know, billions of years or 6,000 years, depending on how you count, there's no reason for that to happen tomorrow as well. Yet everybody believes that this is how it's going to be. So in my capacity as an historian, I'm speaking as a rationalist, not as a believer. And this sometimes creates a discrepancy between the listener's expectation and the things that I'm going to be speaking about. So I just want you to know that I'm aware of this discrepancy. And the fact that I'm describing things in a certain manner does not mean that I don't accept them to happen or some other people to interpret them in a different manner than I do. Actually, it's like driving in a road which has two lanes. You can drive in one lane, you can drive in the other lane. They are both equally legitimate, but you have to decide in which lane you want to drive. So I'm driving the rational lane, okay? And sometimes that could be confusing. For example, I just want to give you a small example to what I mean. Sometimes we see a couple of events that are taking place one next to the other. And those events are somehow linked. And rationalist people would call such events as coincidence. But believers may call it God incidence, meaning that those two events that happened, or several events that happened, didn't happen just happen by accident. It happened for a certain purpose. And a good example is how I came to be dealing with this issue of Messianic Judaism. Because besides my work as a dentist, I'm also a professional genealogist. And a couple of years ago, I was publishing my trade here in the United States, stressing the point that I was doing Jewish genealogy. And I expected to get calls from Jews. But to my surprise, I got at least half of the people who approached me were Christians. And it always came with the same story. We know that we are Christians, our parents were Christian, our grandparents were Christians, but deep inside, we feel Jewish. And we want you to reveal to us, perhaps there's someone Jewish in our family. Please do that for us, which I did. And this became very popular. And one day, a woman approached me with a similar request, only that this time she told me that she knew of one of her ancestors, that he was a Jew who converted and became a missionary, and she wanted to learn more about him, because there are all sorts of stories about him, and she wanted to know more about him. And this person's name was Leopold Cohen. And so she needed for me to corroborate the facts that she had heard and that she found written in some of the books that were written about Leopold Cohen. Now, Leopold Cohen, as we will be talking about him, he was born in a very small village in a very remote area of Hungary, of old Hungary. Now it's no longer Hungary. This is a remote area who nobody in the world knows anything about it, except for one person. And that one person was me, because I wrote my dissertation on that specific area. It means that if she would have looked all around the world for the best person to do it, it would have been me. And she called me without even knowing that. Moreover, when Leopold Cohen began his serious activity, he moved his center to Williamsburg. And who is the guy who wrote a second dissertation about Williamsburg? It was me. So you can see, you can view this maybe as a rationalist, as a coincidence, or as this woman described it, this was a God incidence. She felt that I was sent by heaven to answer her questions. So this is why I began this talk in this way, because both explanations are acceptable to me. You can either choose this one or that one, but now we can start the real talk. So, ever since the early days of Christianity, it was generally accepted that a person could be either a Jew or a Christian, but not both. This, however, changed in the beginning of the 19th century. A man named Isaac Leib Yosefovich was a young Orthodox Jew who grew up in a small Jewish small village in Hungary. He was taught in an ultra-Orthodox way. In the early 1890s, he came to America. Shortly thereafter, he converted, ordained as a priest, changed his name to Leopold Cohen, and became a missionary. Unlike traditional missionaries who persuaded Jews to convert to Christianity, he suggested another missionary approach. This approach evolved in Europe in the early 19th century and was later known as Messianic Judaism. This approach encouraged Jews to retain the former identity, traditions, and sacred texts, but to adopt Jesus as the Messiah and the New Testament as an equally holy addition to the Bible. Cohen claimed that that would not only make them better Jews, but would also win them a higher spiritual status than people who were born Christians. In Europe, Messianic Judaism gained very little success. Yet in America, under Cohen's leadership, it became the largest mission to the Jews ever. Since its establishment on American soil, this movement has gained millions of supporters, and the numbers continue to grow. Nowadays, Cohen's Chosen People Ministries celebrates 125 years to its establishment. And I'm glad to take part in this historical event that we celebrate now. Well, my name is Mendy Karen, you've heard. I'm partially observant Orthodox Israeli Jew, and I take this opportunity to thank Dr. Zehava and Dr. Mitch Glazer for inviting me to give this lecture, and I want to thank you also for attending it. And the slide, please. Since ancient time, Gentiles have tried to convert Jews. Sometimes they have done that, they've done this through cultural influence and intellectual persuasion, and sometimes by imposing financial sanctions, social restrictions, or even threats of deportation and death. In response, the rabbis have stated that converting to another religion is such a grave sin that a Jew is obliged to give up his life rather than commit it. The Jewish people have regarded converts with disgust, treated them as traitors, and excommunicated them and their families. Efforts to convert the Jews intensified following the rise of Christianity. The new religion, I mean Christianity, saw itself as a continuation of true Judaism and often claimed that the Jews who did not believe in Jesus caused his death. During the 18th century, following the end of the Middle Ages, Christian missionary efforts have intensified. Just as other missions operated among people in Asia, Africa, Far East, and South America, so numerous missions specifically targeted the Jews. Most Jews, however, shunned Christians in general and missionaries in particular. Yet, for a few Jews, the economic and social benefits that came along with conversion to Christianity were a temptation they couldn't resist. Despite the missionaries' efforts, the number of converts remained relatively low, as their quality, so to speak. It was clear that most Jewish converts to Christianity were not motivated by a strong inner belief. I'm saying most, because some of them made it out of the full belief. Yes, Ellen corrected me on that yesterday. But most of them, as we have the text and the stories, did it for materialistic and social reasons. Seeking to attract a larger variety of Jews, some Protestant missions, especially in England and Scotland, no longer sought to fully convert the Jews, but rather encouraged them to preserve the Jewish identity, while at the same time accepting Jesus Christ as a savior and the New Testament as their additional Bible. These converts were known as Christian Jews. The movement did not gain much success, and it seems that there were no more than a few hundred Christian Jews in all of Europe at that time. Slide, please. Thank you. Yitzhak Aryeh, or Isaac Leib Yosovich, was born in 1862 in the village of Brezna in Maramures County in eastern Hungary. This was a remote region which was sparsely populated, and most of the people who lived there, including the Jews, were poor farmers. You can see some images. Those are Jewish farmers. That's a rare sight in Europe, because usually Jews used to be merchants, peddlers, bankers, things like that. There were very few Jewish farmers, as we can see here. This is a typical view of a village in the region. You see, it's very poor. It looks like a real shtetl. This is a picture of a Jewish family. You can see the red spot where the region is today. It's on the border between Romania and the Ukraine. The Jews of that region were known for their strong religious beliefs, their Hasidic lifestyle, the absolute compliance with the rabbi's command. Like all other children, Isaac Leib also grew up in an ultra-Orthodox environment and received traditional Jewish education. This included acquiring basic reading and writing skills, which were used to study some parts of the Old Testament and the basic study of the Talmud. Then the boys were sent to study in a yeshiva. Yeshiva is a higher education institution dedicated solely to Talmudic studies. Next slide, please. At the age of 7, Isaac Leib's father died, and after his bar mitzvah, his mother sent him to a Hasidic yeshiva in Siget, the county capital. The head of the yeshiva, Rabbi Yakuti Elihuda Teitelbaum, who was also the chief rabbi of the town, was a Hasidic leader who became known for his zealous outlook. A few years later, Yosovich decided to continue his studies in Hungary's most prestigious yeshiva located in Presburg, today Bratislava, the capital of Slovakia. There, according to his own testimony, he was ordained as a rabbi. This is a picture, no, just keep with the old one. Yeah, this is a picture of the town of Siget in the 18th century. This also. The area was very, people were very interested in the sort of life those rural Jews used to live. So the picture on the right, on the upper right side, is by a journalist named George Pennell, I think. He was a British journalist who went to Europe to see how the Jews live. And he wrote actually a series of articles which were later on published as a book. So this is his own drawings of the Jews in Siget. You can see that they are wearing their Hasidic garments and hats and everything like you would see today. If you go to Williamsburg, you see the same sights there as they were. This was painted in 1890, roughly. So this was the town where Isaac Leib studied in the yeshiva. After his graduation, Yosovich married Rosa, the daughter of an established Jew from another village in Maramuresh, and as was customary in those days, the couple moved to live with their bride's parents. A year later, the father-in-law, who had until then supported the couple, died. Consequently, Yosovich had to take over the business and to manage the local inn. Giving his extensive Talmudic knowledge, and although he was not officially ordained to that place, the local Jews used to consult him on all religious matters. In 1891, Yosovich and his brother-in-law were accused of forging an ownership document of a piece of land that belonged to one of the clients who had passed away without heirs. Not expecting a fair trial, Yosovich fled the country, leaving behind his wife with the four children, Benjamin, Joseph, Joshua, and Esther. After a long journey, he arrived in the United States. Slide, please. After his arrival in New York in 1892, Yosovich sought the help of Rabbi Hillel Klein, here on the left, who emigrated to America a year before. Rabbi Klein, who headed the largest Orthodox community of Hungarian Jews in New York, was unable to help Yosovich to find the rabbinical position he sought. Shortly thereafter, Yosovich met Herman Warszawiak, a Polish Jewish immigrant who had converted and become a successful missionary. Warszawiak convinced Yosovich to follow in his footsteps and even obtained a scholarship for him at a Christian institution in Edinburgh, Scotland. Yosovich traveled to Scotland, where he was reunited with his wife and children, who also converted. He excelled in his studies and was ordained as a Baptist pastor. After returning to New York, Isaac Leib Yosovich changed his name to Leopold Cohen. In 1894, Cohen established his own mission and called it the Chosen People. Shortly thereafter, a Jew named Adolf Benjamin published in the local Jewish newspaper the facts about Cohen's dubious past. Despite the negative publicity, Cohen acquired the trust of a local Baptist church, which provided him with financial support. Since there were many missions at the time who were attempting to appeal to the Jews, Cohen had to establish his own strategy. He did that in two ways. Firstly, he adopted and expanded the idea of Messianic Judaism, which he had probably picked up in Europe and which he preferred to regular convention. Secondly, he divided his time and energy and spent as much time and effort preaching and working among the Christians whom he convinced to contribute their time and money as he did among the Jews. Cohen, whose son David had just been born, rented a building in Brownsville, Brooklyn, which was one of the largest concentrations of Jewish immigrants. The missionary station he established offered medical consultation, supplied used clothes that his Christian supporters donated, and delivered food packages to the poor. He then set up English language classes and opened a sewing school. There, unskilled Jewish women were trained so they could find work in the garment industry sweatshop. This was virtually the only place where an other educated woman who did not speak English could find work. Cohen relied on the ignorance of the immigrants, who did not distinguish between the Reform yet Jewish temples and those who belonged to the mission. He invited Jews to celebrate the Sabbath and the Jewish holiday in a traditional atmosphere. Thanks to his rabbinical knowledge, he delivered sermons that to the unaware ears of the newcomers sounded like the one they were used to listen in the synagogue in the old homelands. Having caught the attention of his audience, he slowly incorporated his messianic messages in his speech. Unlike other missionaries who persuaded Jews to abandon their Jewish legacy and to replace it with a Christian one, he urged Jewish listeners to embrace the belief of in Christ as a full realization of their Jewish identity. Slide, please. Cohen directed much of his time and energy to creating strong links with the Christian community. In 1895, he began publishing the Chosen People magazine. He used it to report to his Christian readers about his activities and persuaded them to contribute money and to volunteer in his mission. A year later, he published his first book in Yiddish entitled, What is His Name and What is His Son's Name? In the ensuing years, he published several other books in Hebrew, Yiddish, and English, including Messiah Be Cut Off and Behold the Virgin. The Jewish and Christian missionaries who preceded him regarded the Jews as traitors and evildoers and regarded the Christians as superior to them. Consequently, they encouraged Jews to abandon their inferior standing and to embrace Christianity's supreme status. Cohen, on the contrary, regarded Jews as a chosen people, as reflected in the name he chose for his mission. He implored the Jews to retain their Jewish identity while also acknowledging Christ as the true Messiah, as in the New Testament, as a direct continuation of the Old One. To his Christian listeners, he explained that the spiritual virtue of Messianic Jews is actually higher than that of native Christians, since they resemble Jesus, who was also a Jew. He then argued that only a converted Jewish rabbi, like himself, can convince other Jews to adopt Jesus. Cohen was a great orator, and although he managed to convert relatively a small number of Jews, he was able to persuade many Christians to support his work. Slide, please. In 1897, Cohen relocated his mission to a central street in Williamsburg and renamed it the Williamsburg Mission to the Jews. This neighborhood was home to many formerly Hungarian Orthodox Jews who had moved there from Manhattan's Lower East Side. By the turn of the 20th century, the Williamsburg Mission was already considered the most successful of the dozens of missions operating among the Jews in America. Slide, please. Over the years, the mission expanded its activities. By the early 1900s, it also offered recreational activities for boys and girls, which allowed their mother to go out to work. It also offered medical services, which were provided by doctors and by nurses who worked in the clinic he established or visited the sick in the homes. We see here the sewing school day off in Brighton, Coney Island, Brighton Beach, yes? And we see here the Sunday school with the hat for the little children so the mother could go to work. And we see here some of the messages speaking about the working, the medical missionary, and the sewing school. They used to give a report every few weeks about what was going on. Over the years, the mission expanded his activities. Due to his success, Cohen had acquired many supporters, but also many enemies. His name became notorious among the Jews and also among some of the Christians who saw him as a charlatan and an exploiter. The Jewish leadership found it difficult to effectively act against Cohen's mission. This was because in Christian America, which was partly anti-Semitic, such activity was considered legitimate and even welcomed. Slide, please. In addition, Jewish society was itself divided. Orthodox Jews felt that the larger Reform and conservative communities posed a far greater threat to them than the small group of converted Jews. Cohen complained that on several instances, his workers faced threats and violent attacks. Yet by and large, a Jewish community response was confined to the publication of a few books and articles in the local Jewish press and the distribution of warning posters and leaflets. Notwithstanding his efforts to convert them, Cohen regarded himself to be the protector of the Jews. For example, in 1899, he asked the New York City Education Commissioner to remove books like Walter Scott's Ivanhoe and Shakespeare's The Merchant of Venice that portrayed Jews in negative light. 2 years later, he responded to the accusation that Jews refrained from waving flags to mark the death of President Theodore Roosevelt. He publicly explained that the president has died during Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year, and that all the Jews have been in the synagogue and were unaware of what happened. Slide, please. With the rise of anti-Semitism in the early 20th century, Cohen delivered countless sermons to the Christian public, reminding them that Christians have a historical debt towards the older brothers, namely the Jews. He pleaded them to be more tolerant and not to offend, insult, or discriminate against the poor Jewish immigrants. Like many other evangelicals, Cohen regarded Zionism and the return of Jews to the land of Israel as a fulfillment of the Messianic redemption prophecy. To help the Zionist movement, Cohen raised funds among Christians and encouraged them to purchase products that were produced in the Holy Land, as we can see here, lily bulbs and Palestine soap. And this is a notification about the Zionist Congress. It used to have a couple of these. This one is, I didn't find them in English, so I brought the Hebrew version, actually the Yiddish version. Slide, please. In 1906, Cohen used some of the money he collected to purchase a large farm and country house in Connecticut. In 1907, Cohen received a very substantial donation from a wealthy woman named Frances Huntley. Cohen refused to share this donation with the Baptist Church, which had previously supported him. The church leaders accused Cohen of violating his agreement with them and removed the sponsorship from Cohen's mission. Regardless, the donation was big enough and Cohen's reputation was solid enough to allow him to continue his operation and to raise funds independently. Cohen also encouraged his son Joseph to conclude his Christian training. In 1908, Joseph, of whom we will hear more tomorrow by Mitch Glazer, he was ordained as a pastor and began to participate in the mission's activity, which as a result became a family business. Unlike his father, who spoke with a heavy accent, Joseph's English, which he acquired from an early age in the United States, was totally native. This assisted him as he traveled to many Christian communities across the country. On these trips, Joseph delivered countless sermons in which he told his Christian listeners about his father's missionary activities and asked for the donation and support. Like his father, Joseph also became a protector of the Jews and spoke out against slandering of the Jews and discriminating against them. He likewise described the many ways in which Jews contributed to the world in general and to America in particular. Slide, please. In 1908, the father and son set up another missionary station in Coney Island, where many Jews spent their summer vacations. The money they now have had enabled them to purchase a piece of land in the heart of Williamsburg. There, Cohen built his own building, which was completed a few years later. The building, named the House of the Prince of Peace, served as the mission's headquarters and activity center. Slide, please. The same year, Cohen confronted Philip Spivak and David Shapiro, two converted Jews who also ran a mission in Brooklyn. The two, who wished to undermine Cohen's credibility, visited his country house in Connecticut. Cohen had claimed that the farm was part of his missionary institutions, and the two sought to demonstrate that the house was used only by his family. Upon their arrival, they confronted Joshua, Cohen's third son, who pulled a gun at them. The controversy between the three converted Jews drew, of course, the attention of the local newspapers, and in the ensuing years, the press reported extensively on the mutual defamation war, which was carried out both on the streets and in courts. Cohen's negative image intensified following his wife's death in 1908. He immediately married Edith, who was 32 years younger, explaining that his sole reason for doing so was a willingness to raise his little son, David. In an effort to salvage his public image, Cohen published his autobiography, which was titled The Story of a Modern Missionary to an Ancient People, The Autobiography of Leopold Cohen, a Missionary Among the 2 Million Jews of Greater New York. In subsequent editions, and due to the negative criticism he received, he used the less bombastic figures and claimed that he was just preaching to the 300,000 Jews of Brooklyn. In 1913, prior to the First World War, Cohen's relative arrived in the United States. Following a harsh dispute that broke out, they sued him. At the trial, the relative revealed that his real name was indeed Yosovich, and he had never been ordained as a rabbi, but was, in fact, a simple innkeeper. They also exposed his involvement in the forging of the deed documents and his escape from Hungary before trial. These allegations undermined Cohen's credibility, and the church had to establish a special investigation committee, which published its report in 1916. The committee acquitted Cohen of all guilt and encouraged Christians to continue to contribute to his missionary activities. Slide, please. 2 years later, in 1918, Alexander Bacon, a Christian colonel, lawyer, and author, we see him here, published a book titled The Strange Case of Dr. Cohen and Mr. Yosovich, and added in a sarcastic manner with an apology to Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. The book reviewed the facts that were revealed in the recent years and accused Cohen of hiding the truth from his followers and acting in a dishonest manner. We can see here the notification about the investigation committee. And this is the opening page of the book. Slide, please. This was too much for Cohen, and in 1920 he resigned his role as the head of the mission and was succeeded by his son Joseph. Joseph expanded the mission's outreach, and within a decade he opened branches in Philadelphia, Atlantic City, and Pittsburgh. During this period, Leopold wrote books and published new editions of his earlier books. In 1920, he also began to publish another Masle journal titled Shepherd of Israel, which was written both in Yiddish and English. Alongside religious issues, the journal also addressed political news concerning the life of the Jews. For example, it reported on the implementation of the 1917 Balfour Declaration, who promised the Jews to have their own national home in Palestine. He also reported on the visit to New York by prominent Zionist leader Chaim Weizmann, who became Israel's first president. It reported of the new Zionist settlements, the kibbutzim, in Palestine, and he especially reported on the rise of anti-Semitism in Europe in the early 1930s. The Shepherd of Israel specifically warned its readers of Adolf Hitler's rise to power and the danger he posed to the Jewish people. In 1930, and as an expression of appreciation for his lifelong missionary work, Leopold Cohen was awarded an honorary doctorate by the Evangelical Wheaton College of Illinois. That same year, Cohen publicly attacked the fundamentalist pastor William Bale Riley for his anti-Semitic talks about a global Jewish conspiracy. Slide, please. Leopold Cohen died at the end of 1937 at the age of 75. The mission which he founded, which in 1924 was renamed the American Board of Missions to the Jews, greatly expanded under the management of his son Joseph. He had several branches in the United States, but also in Poland, Germany, Australia, France, Latvia, and even in Jerusalem. Joseph continued to develop the organization until his death in 1953 and established more branches both in America and abroad. After 70 years under the leadership of the Cohen family, the missions management transferred to other people. These included Harry Pertlov, Daniel Fuchs, and Harold Sevener, and the current president is, of course, Dr. Mitch Glaser. Today, 125 years after it was founded, the Chosen People Ministry operates in many countries and caters to hundreds of thousands of people, including many Jews. Cohen's greatest success led to the spreading of the idea of Messianic Judaism. Today, there are many dozens of Messianic movements which have millions of supporters all over the world, including many Jews. Slide, please. You see here some of the Messianic Jews. They're very different in character one from one another. From a traditional Jewish perspective, if we disregard for a moment Cohen's missionary goals, it can be stated that his activities in favor of the Jewish immigrants did not fall short of those of any other Jewish leader. He helped them to integrate into American society by teaching them English and by giving them professional training that allowed them to support themselves and their families. Cohen also provided them with social and medical services that they could not otherwise receive. Paradoxically, Cohen also preserved the Jewish identity of many of the young immigrants who, like himself, came to America without their families. Living alone, they had no place to celebrate the Sabbath and the Jewish holidays. But when they visited his mission, they were treated like a family and were reminded of the traditional foods, prayers, melodies, and religious rituals, such as the fasting and praying on Yom Kippur, eating matzah on Passover, and lighting the Hanukkah candles. Cohen also enjoyed a unique position that allowed him to influence a large Christian public. He often reminded them that they should respect the Jews and support them until they discover the truth and embrace Christ. He strongly opposed anti-Semitic manifestation in the American public and had openly supported Zionism. According to Cohen's own testimony, we can estimate that throughout his career, he managed to influence only a few hundred Jews. Consequently, from a non-religious point of view, it can be said that Cohen's contribution to the Jewish immigrants and to American Jews in general was far greater than the so-called harm, harm meaning conversion, that he caused. In fact, the same can be said of contemporary Messianic Judaism movements, which are comprised of a large majority of non-Jews. Despite their intentions to convince Jews to accept Jesus, the success rates are relatively small. On the other hand, the firm support of the Jewish people in general and of the Jewish state of Israel in particular is invaluable. I would like to conclude this lecture with a personal note. I am a proud Israeli Jew and forever will remain one. This, however, does not mean that I do not appreciate the support that the people of Israel and the state of Israel get from non-Jewish individuals and organizations, and especially from many evangelical groups. Today, when top officials in the Trump administration, such as the Secretary of State Mike Pompeo and Vice President Mike Pence, are evangelical Christians, the support Israel gets from the United States is overwhelming. This, however, was not always the case. Reviewing history, we can say that Leopold Cohen and his son Joseph were among the first to openly express their commitment to the Jewish people and to the Zionist idea. They have spread those views among millions of Christian listeners, including thousands of clergymen. The Christian people who listened to them suddenly realized that instead of the centuries-old hate tradition, which was the only tradition they knew, they should love the Jews and support them. We can therefore conclude that Leopold Cohen and his son were among the first to make the love to Jews and the love to Zionism related to the state of Israel as one of the top values of evangelical Christianity. So consequently, Well, I myself do not approve of any type of missionary work, be it Christian, Jewish, Muslim, or otherwise. I wish to express my gratitude to Leopold Cohen's Chosen People Ministries. Slide, please. Throughout the many decades that have passed, they have supported the Jewish people and the State of Israel, shared the suffering and anxiety in bad time, joined the happiness in better time, and contributed to the well-being all the time. Thank you all. I salute you.
Take a few questions. Okay, well, I'd like to open the microphone up to people who may have some questions and give Mendy the opportunity to respond. So make your comment in the form of a question, if you can. All right.
Doctor, we're deeply appreciative and very grateful to you for introducing us to a new perspective on Leopold Cohen. We are, of course, not as familiar as you are with the circumstances which were gone into in so much detail by courts and by investigations. What was your assessment of the events which obviously drove him to America and later seemed to pursue him in such a difficult way? The circumstances which obviously were an embarrassment and in certain ways hard to explain later.
So this brings me right back to where I opened my speech. It depends how you see it. You can see it as an embarrassment, or you can see it in God's way to send him to America, which was the way God decided that this was his destination, that he should go to America, that he should go there alone, that he should go there humiliated, and that he should go there and not find work in what he wanted to do. And then God diverted him to another way. So this is one way of looking at it. And we can look at it the way maybe other people looked at it, saying that this was a man who disguised his real past, his name, his dubious, maybe criminal acts beforehand. So it depends on the point of view that you want to choose. So either point of view is legitimate.
If I can ask a follow-up question on that, like just to pry into that a little bit more, like what was he like fleeing from a situation of like an anti-Semitic court where he wouldn't have a fair chance in a certain situation, or is that not going on here in the Hungarian situation?
Okay, from an historical point of view, at that time, Hungarian Jews had full civil rights. So there was no need for him, if he wasn't indeed guilty of something or suspected of being guilty, he didn't have a reason to flee. So rationally speaking, he fled because he was in fact guilty. And we know that because his accomplice, which was his brother-in-law, was tried and sentenced to prison, which means that he was indeed guilty and the two co-opted together in this wrongdoing. So we know that this, I've said that he ran away because he felt he wouldn't get a fair trial. But this is his own description. This is not the way that other people saw it. Other people just realized that he have tried to do something wrong and he was caught and he had to face trial on that account.
His work with Wozniak, Herman Wozniak, how much influence did it have in the direction that he gave to his own ministry? What was the interaction between Herman Wozniak and Cohen? It is my understanding that they were, I mean, working together for quite a while until they split. Do you have any knowledge of that, or?
I don't have specific knowledge about that. I know that Vashovyak was a relatively successful missionary until he got complicated in some story and had to quit, and it had a bad ending, the Vashovyak. I don't remember exactly how it ended, but it didn't end well for him. And we know about his interaction with Cohen through Cohen's writing. And of course, Cohen didn't elaborate on that too much because he presumably wanted to take the credit to himself. So he just mentioned Vashovyak as the person who gave him the first lead, but he didn't say any more about it. Also, we know that Vashovyak was not preaching to Messianic Judaism. He was preaching to regular conversion. So he didn't take that from Vashovyak. It's something that he himself developed, the idea of Messianic Judaism. Of course, he picked it up in Europe, but then he developed it himself, which was not what Vashovyak was doing, which was more traditional conversion.
I just had a question about the other children. I know Joseph and the sister Esther were the only ones to continue on in the mission afterwards. I just wonder if you knew why the other siblings didn't, even though if you had any insight on that.
Well, I don't have an answer, but the simple answer is that, you know, there are many people here who have parents doing something, and the children are not following on in the footsteps. Some of them does go into the family business, and other just don't. They don't appeal to them. It doesn't appeal to their personality. I think one of Leopold Cohen was a lawyer. The other was, I don't know, a journalist. The other one took care of the farm. So that's there's no specific reason why they didn't do what the father did. Yeah.
I really appreciated the research you've done on this, but I think it would be fair to just say that not everybody believed that he really was Yitzhak Yakubovich. There is the other side to it, that Spivak, who accused him of being this person back in Hungary, described Yitzhak Yakubovich as having, I believe he said he had blue eyes when Cohen had brown eyes, and he said he had a round chin, and Cohen had never, I believe he had a square chin. There was a lot, enough discrepancies there that a group of Christian ministers who had turned on Cohen decided that this was not true and instead changed their mind and agreed that he really was Leopold Cohen. So the fact that he was Yakubovich was perhaps invented by Wozniak, who was, you know, opposing him. I just think we need to be aware that, we need just to be aware that not everybody was believing that he was Yakubovich. Just for the audience to have the other side. And he was exonerated as well because the facts just didn't match up.
There was a question in the accusation that Leopold Cohen, or whatever his name would have been, was never ordained a rabbi. What can you tell us about that? Was he ordained rabbi?
Okay, the most reliable sources that we have on that topic, both on his being ordained or not, and about his family origin, were exposed in the court which dealt with his feud with his own family. So it was his own family, I mean, his sister and his brother-in-law and some other relatives who came to court and told the court actually, that his name was Rossovich. So they are the people who knew him and to whom he acknowledged them as his family. He didn't disconnect himself from them. So he acknowledged that they were his family, and they came out and said his name was Yosovich, and he was never ordained as a rabbi. And we know this to be true also, that he wasn't ordained as a rabbi, because we have the name of the rabbis who were ordained in the Pressburg Yeshiva, and he is not on that list. I've checked this, and he is not on the list. In fact, most of the pupils in the yeshiva were not ordained as rabbis. They studied there, but they were not ordained. Only a small number of them were ordained as rabbis. And he never presented, even in the trial, when faced with that question, Cohen's lawyer stated that he said on record, he said, we never claimed that Cohen was a rabbi. We never said it. This is a quotation for the court hearing.
Of all the options that were available for him, why, you know, sort of probably many options were open for him. Why do you think he chose Christianity?
I know there is a saying in Talmudic Hebrew. Sometimes you do things not really meaning to do them, but out of that comes something which is true. So I'm not sure exactly what was his primary intentions were. Maybe he was just alone, maybe he didn't have any work, maybe a Warshaviak told him, look, this is a good profession, you could make good money, you have the qualities. If you cannot teach, the Jewish scriptures to you know, as a rabbi, you can teach them as a pastor. I don't know what was his initial motivation were, but the end result was that he fell in love with Christianity, and we see the way he speaks about his mission. He's very much devoted and enthusiastic to what he is doing. He speaks very passionately about it. So I was convinced, even though I wasn't sure what was the first motivation, I'm sure that maybe after the first couple of months, maybe a year, he got very much into it and became a full believer. And this came out through in his sermon, in his text.
Let's take a moment and express our appreciation to Mendy again. Thank you.
And remark. I just want to make sure so everybody would understand. I think that Leopold Cohen was a great person. I really admire him for his achievement. And the fact that someone is doing something at one point in time, and that thing continues to hold out throughout so many generations, throughout 125 years, that proves that there was a real point, a real true point in what he was doing. So this is just to clarify things where I'm standing. Thank you.